right, this is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you here in Phoenix, Arizona, and I'm here at Green Life Nursery by Seamus O'Leary. So I visited Seamus many years ago when he had a different property. He's now moved onto a 3-acre property, and Seamus at this point has been basically selling and growing fruit trees now for the last 12 years here in the Phoenix area. And this is the video that you will want to watch if you want to grow subtropical and tropical fruit trees here in Phoenix. He has a lot of experience growing these trees and, more importantly, selling them to you guys. But even more important than that, he provides you guys the education you need to be successful, because some of these fruit trees are not a walk in the park. They can take some care and maintenance. If you don't do them, you will lose them. And I want you guys to be successful with all your growing, whether you're growing fruit trees or vegetables. I want you to be successful so that you will continue to grow instead of give it up, right? The other thing, he has a lot of practices such as mulching and growing in, building soil, because the soil here is not that good. I mean, if we just look across the way, it's basically like desert sand over here. So he literally has been on this property for like 3 years, and we're going to go ahead and take you guys inside and show you guys some established fruit trees that he has growing in the ground. But more importantly, we're going to show you the wealth of fruit trees he has in pots available for you guys, some of which you can't get anywhere else in Arizona. He's the only guy that sells some of these rare varieties that can grow good here if they're taken care of, and that's what I hope to share with you guys today. Now we're here at the entrance to the nursery, where they just have tons and tons of different trees that you guys can buy and grow here in Phoenix. Now, Seamus will start some of the trees here and propagate them. Many of them are actually brought in here to Phoenix and contract grown for him. And that's why you could get things here that you literally can't get anywhere else. These are just not off the shelf stock, sold at normal nursery. So if you guys are looking for those rare trees, if he don't got it, you probably can't get it. Now, what's very important to me as somebody who gardens and teaches gardening, and especially has visited to other places and other, people's homes and here in Arizona that are growing tropicals, and sometimes they don't do so well, right? That's because people don't understand that you can't just buy a mango tree and plant it out and then water it once in a while and forget about it, right? The mango tree will not make it, right? This is Arizona. This is Phoenix. This is not Hawaii. This is not, Asia in the climate that the mangoes would optimally like, which actually wouldn't even be that humid. It would be dry. So the mangoes could totally handle the dry, and it loves the heat. It cannot handle the cold temperatures, especially when young, and it can't also handle the soil pH. You need to feed it properly. There's a bunch of things you need to do. I'm not going to get into the anatomy of how to grow a mango tree, but what I want to say is that basically we're in a zone 9B here. If you're in Miami, right? Miami, Florida is like a zone 10. And if you live in Hawaii, that's a zone 12, right? So these zones are different. That means you can't just plant the tree in the ground and walk away and expect nothing to happen, or for it to live. It won't make it. So what I wanted to do for you guys in this video is literally break it down super simple, super easy. And how I'm gonna do that is, for those of you guys that wanna basically just plant something and just about ignore it, I have a tree that you guys can grow to do that. For those of you guys that wanna be rewarded and actually get fruit off a tree, I'm gonna share with you guys some of the low maintenance trees that you could plant that you need to do minimal things to, like water it. Maybe adjust the soil pH. I'm also gonna share with you guys some medium trees that you might have to do a little bit more than just water it and adjust the soil pH, like regular feeding it, like maybe a little bit of protection sometimes of the year, like the cold weather. Then we're gonna share with you guys some medium high trees that can totally be successful if you pay a little bit more attention to it. And then we're gonna share with you guys some high trees, and there's not many of these guys I wanna share with you guys, because these are the ones that are almost experimental and be very difficult to take care of and get fruit off of. It might be a low, it might be a medium high, in the level of maintenance it requires. And so you have to match up how much maintenance you want to do with the tree, and then you have to say, will you do that maintenance? And if you're not going to do the maintenance for the tree, you have no reason to buy that tree, because you're going to kill it. And that's not a fun life for the tree or for you or your pocketbook when you're having to spend your hard-earned cash on a tree. And of course, if you want mangoes, you can grow them here in Phoenix. You just need to make sure you do what it takes to grow them. So that's what I'm going to share with you guys in this episode, so that you guys can be successful and choose the tree that is appropriate to the level of care that you want to give. Much like many of you guys may have a boyfriend or girlfriend, a husband or wife, and some of you guys have a high maintenance girlfriend, husband or wife, right? And you guys are cool with that, because you know you got to like really take them out and take them shopping. You got to tell them you love them every 5 minutes. You got to, I don't know, buy them luxury purses every couple weeks, you know? That's too high maintenance for me. Like, I'm not that high maintenance. Like, but some of you guys don't mind that. Maybe you're rich and you can just throw money away and stuff, and you got a cool, nice girl that appreciates it all. I'm kind of like more in the, like, maybe medium low maintenance. Like, you know, I want the girl to be able to take care of herself. I'll definitely tell her I like her and love her, and I'll do things for her and stuff. But I'm not about to like do extra stuff, because my life is already so complex as it is. And this is how I'm going to relate it to the trees in this episode. And you know, so I want you guys to understand where I'm coming from, so that you guys get the tree and you can be successful and have some fruit here in Phoenix. This video is specifically made for Phoenicians that want to grow tropical fruit trees. I'm going to tell you first off, Seamus is the place you want to go. Don't go to your local nursery. They're not going to tell you all the practices you need to do to be successful. Seamus cares that you get the tree, and more importantly, treat the tree right so you can be successful. And other places will just say, oh yeah, just buy the tree and plant it in the ground. Everything's going to be fine. Well, yeah, come back in 2 years. Why didn't you get fruit when you planted that tree from the nursery, you know, that they said you could just plant and grow in the ground? Because you didn't do what it takes. You didn't take care of it, right? If you don't take care of your girlfriend, your boyfriend, your husband or wife, guess what? They're gonna get a divorce. They're gonna leave you there and find somebody else that can take care of their needs. So the first tree I'm gonna show you guys today on my journey around Seamus's amazing nursery are these guys. These are called the Moringa trees. And these are trees that basically you can just about ignore. Now, yes, you need to get them a little bit of water, because it doesn't like rain here much in Phoenix. But basically, if you take care of these trees too much, they're gonna check out, right? They're not gonna grow well. They're not gonna do well. Maybe you overwater your Moringa and it doesn't grow. That's because you're overwatering it, right? These are actually planted in an irrigation ditch. And if they irrigate this ditch too much, these trees don't perform as well as if they basically like let them fend for themselves. Of course, all plants and trees need some amount of water, so don't like just totally not water them. But once they're established, you know, basically they don't need a lot of water. I mean, if you get regular rains wherever you live, it might grow well. But these guys, I mean, we're here in March. A lot of the Moringas around the property that aren't in, you know, the ideal situation have defoliated. They've lost their leaves. You know, there's plenty of leaves on here. You get all these leaves are edible. It's also starting to push out the flowers, and then it'll actually make the Moringa pods or the drumstick fruit. And is the seeds that are also edible that can be used to, you know, purify water. So this is the tree that if you want to do nothing or very little or ignore it, the Moringa tree is for you, right? Because I know some of you guys just think you could buy the tree here, put it in the ground and basically ignore it and it's going to do well. Well, yeah, with the Moringa, but nothing else. So let's go on a journey and share with you guys now some of the trees that are going to take a little bit more care than the Moringa, that you will have to water, you will have to adjust the pH, and you will have to, more importantly, feed your tree. Think about it. We eat. How many times do you guys eat a day? 3 times a day, maybe 4. Some of you guys are snackers and you have little like snacks all day long. We eat all day, and you expect to plant your tree in the ground and then you never feed it. You plant it and you're expected to give you fruit? Dude, you gotta like contribute to your relationship. You gotta build that relationship with your girlfriend, boyfriend, husband, or wife, and you gotta feed your girlfriend, husband, or wife, or boyfriend, but you also gotta feed your trees. So, you know, Seamus has learned that using things like worm castings and compost teas and foliar feeding of kelp and other things are very critical, because the more you feed your tree, the more productive it will be for you. So you wanna nurture your trees, and more importantly, nurture relationships so that you're not single like me. All right, so the first low maintenance tree you guys can grow are right here. These are pomegranates, right? These are actually planted out in the parking lot, kind of against the fence here. And actually these are used for the propagation actually. They have different varieties and they take cuttings off these guys to make more trees. And you guys can see, I mean, Seamus really doesn't do anything with the fruit. These were not harvested. And what happens is these basically will open up on the tree like this and all the pomegranate seeds fall out so they could maybe grow more sprouts underneath and or the birds get them. Right? This is literally a tree that, aside from being in an irrigation ditch that he might flood a little bit in the summertime, he hasn't done anything to, and it is thriving, right? For those of you guys that want to do low maintenance, maybe water once in a while and do a few things in the soil, feed a little bit, right? Grow a pomegranate because you will have fruit without any issues. So another low maintenance crop you could grow here in Phoenix is more of a tropical versus a subtropical, and that is the Barbados cherry or Acerola cherry. These are takes like a cross between apple and cherries. I would encourage you guys to ask Seamus for the purple variety of Barbados cherries. They are more anthocyanin content, which I'm really into. Check the link down below for my video on anthocyanins, a very important plant pigment that the plants make that are important for our health. Anyways, the Barbados cherries are super easy. You might have to protect them from the winter time the first couple years, and then, or the first year or two, and then you're totally good. And you're like, John, why are you showing trees, man? They don't look that good, right? Why are they like, you know, turning like brown and like dying? These tips are dying, right? Well, here's the thing. A lot of these trees are not necessarily grown here on site, right? They are brought in from other states that have a warmer climate. But the cool thing is, when you come to Seamus, right, especially in March, this is the worst time to come to the nursery because they're getting out of the winter time, right? They have some cold nights here. And what happens to the tropicals when you get cold nights? Well, it turns brown because the plant is responding like, I don't like the cold, I'm a freezing. How would you like sitting outside in the 20 degree weather at night? It wouldn't be too fun. But nonetheless, if the plant makes it through the colder weather, right, it hardens it off. It makes it tough. Like, I work out in the sun. I go out in the wintertime and even work out in the wintertime when it's cold outside so I can better be more resilient to the hot or the cold weather extremes. And because Seamus has these plants here, you know, that have made it through the colder winter and, you know, being damaged a little bit, it's toughing it up to an extent so that it can handle it in the future years. So you're gonna get a stronger plant because it's just literally not fresh off the truck that came in from Florida because it hasn't been sitting here. So I would encourage you guys to look for the plants that don't look 100% perfect, that have some damage to them, but watch out, because in some cases, Seamus will even charge you more for those plants because those are the plants that he wants to keep for himself. So the next low maintenance crop I want you guys to grow, and actually I brought one to my friend today, who's a camera person, are figs. Figs are super easy in Phoenix. They can easily handle the dry, hot weather. You just make sure you need to give them enough water, feed them a little bit, adjust the pH. Now the other tip I want to give you guys is that I want you guys to always buy the largest container size as possible that has the largest tree. Now, why is this important? Yeah, I mean, Seamus probably makes more money on them and they definitely cost more when you buy the bigger size. But what you guys don't understand is, you know, when the plant is young and baby and small, they're not as, tolerant to the extreme temperatures, whether that's the cold or the hot. They're more like babies. You wouldn't throw a baby that's, you know, 2 years old out to fend for itself unless you're in Japan. And actually when the kids are in Japan are like four, they send them out of the house on their own to walk across the street and buy something at the drugstore, which is insane, right? We wouldn't do that in America. So that's why you would always want to get a bigger pot, because it's buying like a teenager that can deal with going out to the drugstore and buying stuff on their own without getting run over by a car or anything else, right? That being said, some of you guys have more money than time, and so that's why I'd say buy a bigger pot. But if you have more time than money, then buy the smaller pot, save some money, but then you gotta baby them and care for them a little bit more. Especially when we get up into some of the different levels of medium hard, buying a larger tree can be of significant benefit and make your job to keep that baby alive longer so that it survives to maturity. And when it's an adult stage, you know, the tropical trees are a lot more resilient to especially the cold weather, more importantly. So probably my favorite fruit tree in this low maintenance category is what I'm standing under right now. And as you guys can see, this thing is loaded to the hilt with fruit. This is a white mulberry tree. And you guys can just see here, I mean, every couple inches, there are just mulberries and mulberries and mulberries. And the mulberries are very simple to take care of. Actually, I had one in a 15-gallon pot and I never planted it in the ground. It actually broke through the pot and then rooted in the ground, and then I never got to move it anywhere else because that's where it wants to live. And I'm like, I'm not moving it at that point. And it got real huge. They're doing an amazing job growing this one. This one is so huge. And actually it's March right now. So there even are, this is one of the earliest fruiting crops. There's even some ripe mulberries on here. So let me go ahead and get one that's kind of almost ripe. This is almost ripe. It's still got some green on the back, but it's mostly white. These guys are just amazing. The reason why you need to grow your own mulberries is because you will probably never find these for sale at the grocery store. Maybe at the farmer's market, but these have a very short shelf life. Wow. But these are, oh my gosh. I miss mulberries so much. I prefer the Pakistani mulberries that are the dark purple ones for their anthocyanins, but these guys are super sweet. And this is probably my top pick that I want you guys to grow in Phoenix if you're new into growing fruit trees. You'll be rewarded every spring with bountiful harvests of delicious mulberries that literally money can't buy. Another low maintenance tree actually I want you guys to grow here in Phoenix, because honestly it is one of my favorite fruit trees in the entire world. It's known as the jujube tree, and they're really easy to take care of. I mean, it'll get weedy on you, and they'll even send up, you know, runners and sprouts in other parts of your yard. And there are many different kinds of varieties. They have actually a unique one here that they have actually planted in the ground that does need to get more sun because it's not performing as well as it should be, despite having the excellent growing practices. I mean, here's some excellent growing practices right here. One of the things I want you guys to do in your yard, check it out. If we look right down below the tree, I'm sitting in basically all this mulch. This mulch is really thick, and when I started walking on this area, I almost felt guilty because I'm compressing the soil because my foot like literally sunk down several inches as I'm walking here, because they're basically covering the ground with good mulch. So they're gonna create more moisture and, more importantly, a better environment for the soil microbiome, the bacteria and fungi. And if we come back here, you can see it's really wet down here. They got these roly-poly bugs that are eating and decomposing. We got I'm seeing white mycelium down here, like mycorrhiza, all kinds of cool stuff happening. So I want you guys to plant your trees well, feed them well, but more importantly, create a good environment, because after all, Phoenix is literally a desert with moon dust in some cases. Anyways, this is a jujube. It's a special variety, I guess, that doesn't ripen like normal. And it doesn't have a weird weird shape. Kind of looks like a titty. And I love these guys because you can eat them like fresh when they're ripe, and or these dry perfectly. So you don't want to leave them out too long because they'll get too hard. But I like to eat jujubes actually not when they're fresh, but when they're perfectly optimally dried. When they're optimally dried, and the ones I get usually are from California, they are kind of like an angel food cake. So they actually have a nice spongy consistency and they're super sweet. And actually, these are also known as Chinese dates and have been used in Chinese medicine for thousands of years. I prefer the jujube, actually, the Chinese date, over the standard date that most people know and love. So we're gonna try this on the camera. Wow, this is actually quite good. So you can see inside there, this is really sweet actually. I'm really impressed for it being so green. This is almost like eating a green apple, but to me it's even sweeter than a green apple, and then even has like better flavor. So actually this is one of the better flavored jujubes I've actually ever had in my life, because normally I don't even like to eat them that fresh. You gotta get a jujube tree. So the last low maintenance tropical tree actually you guys could grow here in Phoenix, believe it or not, is not like a jujube, which could handle the desert and climate, or the fig or the pomegranate. It's a jabuticaba. And a lot of Americans don't know what jabuticaba is. Basically, it's called a tree grape. It's from South America, and basically the fruits grow up the literally the trunk of the tree. They have like, they look like little warts that are growing, and they're just like little black balls that grow up, and they kind of taste like a strong black grape. They also have that purple color that I'm really into, the anthocyanin content, and they're cold hardy. Now here's the thing, right? The biggest challenge you guys are gonna have in Phoenix is the cold weather. unfortunately, or fortunately, where Seamus has his nursery, it's about 10 degrees cooler in the winter than some other parts of Phoenix that can be a lot warmer. This is a benefit because his plants have been hardened off more than what most of you guys are gonna experience, right? These guys have basically been not protected during the winter, and I'm seeing very little damage from the cold weather here. Now, the cool thing to know is that most of the tropical trees, you know, they can easily handle the heat when it's 110 plus degrees here in Phoenix. The big challenge is when it's cold. They cannot handle the cold weather. And this is also provided you feed them right and take care of them and give them proper watering, you know, not too much, not too little, especially some of the tropical trees in the wintertime don't like too much water because they can basically get root rot. So you guys just learned about the low maintenance trees you guys could grow that they're selling here at Seamus, and he has a lot more. I just can only cover a few because I don't want my video to be 2 hours long when my video is already long anyways. Next, I want to get into the medium maintenance trees that you will have to do more than the low maintenance. In general, the medium maintenance trees need maybe more cold protection. In some cases, they may need a little bit more work to, you know, foil or feed them, or feed them a little more often than the low maintenance category. So you're just gonna have to work a little bit harder, but I think you will be rewarded with even some more interesting and better tasting fruits. So let's go ahead and show you guys these medium trees. So the first medium maintenance tree I want to show you guys is the Chico Sapote, also known as the Sapodilla. And this is actually a perfect anti-inflammatory fruit, improves digestion, and the fruit can sell for $10 or more a pound, which is totally insane. They grow really well in Florida, and it's a major export crop for the state of Florida. But why get them exported from Florida when they're picked too early and they never ripen up? So you never get to try them and they're never at their peak ripeness. You could have them in your backyard here in Phoenix if you want to do a little bit of work. And this is how beautiful these Chico Sapotes, also known as Sapodilla trees, are. This happens to be one of my favorite fruits in the entire world. And surely if I lived in Phoenix, I would definitely get one of these guys, and I would just go through the work it took for a medium fruit tree to keep it alive so it can thrive and I can eat some delicious fruit. So for those of you guys that are wondering what a Chico Sapote tastes like, because some of you guys don't even know this, I call this the brown sugar fruit. When you get it at peak ripeness and it's brown on the inside, it just tastes like sweet sugar. The closest thing that I could even relate it to would be kind of like maybe a nice ripe pear texture with a hint of, I don't know, maybe like cinnamon chocolate flavor, but it's not super strong. It's just super sweet and super delicious. I love the texture. And I just love this fruit tree, so you definitely want to get one. The next medium tree that I would grow if I lived here in Phoenix is the guava. I love guavas, they're so good, and it's quite unfortunate that if you go to buy guavas at the grocery store, you know, if they're being imported from outside the United States, they have been irradiated, and I'm not a fan of irradiated food. Luckily for California, a lot of guavas are grown in the San Diego area and then exported certain times of the year. But the problem with store-bought guavas is that they are never as ripe as they should be, right? They pick them early because guavas, once they're ripe, they go bad extremely quickly, and it just does not taste good. And so for that reason, I would grow my own guavas. Seamus has a selection of different varieties and cultivars of guavas. He has several of them in the ground himself. This one in March happens to be fruiting, so I think I see a fruit up there, and we're gonna see if I can grab it off. Carefully, we're gonna bring this branch down, and let's see, it should come off fairly easily when you pull them. All right, that one came off fairly easily. Man, haven't had a guava in Phoenix before, so yeah, it should be nice color, not green. Let's go ahead and open this guy up and see what we got on the inside. Should be a little bit softer. Awesome, look at that. Nice pink guava on the inside, and we're gonna go ahead and taste this. Wow. Guavas are extremely high in vitamin C. This is extremely flavorful, and if I left it up on the tree for another week or two, it'd even be a lot better than it is, but I'm still glad. I mean, this is better than any guava I've ever bought in the store myself, and yet another tree that you guys can grow here. Just remember to protect it from the cold a little bit and take care of it. So the next medium maintenance tree that you guys could buy here in Phoenix if you want to do, once again, medium amount of work and get rewarded, is the lychee tree. I love lychees. They're like basically like a grape. And you can see they got some of the trees here. And here's the thing, you know, the lychees is a big issue growing them in Phoenix is the cold weather. Luckily, as I mentioned before, you know, he's about 10 degrees colder in the wintertime. So you guys can see, you know, some of the tip damage, a little bit of tip damage. You can see like the new growth on here, which is the nice more pale green leaves. And you can see some of the older growth, more green leaves on here. I would definitely encourage you guys to get some lychees. It's quite unfortunate that a lot of lychees that are imported are from Mexico, and actually they're of decent quality, but the ones that come in from China are picked far too early and they're just garbage. So, you know, if you guys want to have the best fruit quality, it's always better to grow it yourself. The last medium maintenance fruit that we'll be sharing with you guys today is the rose apple. Now, for those of you guys that are from Hawaii, knows that basically rose apples kind of grow as a weed, like in the hills, kind of like the guavas. You know, I've been progressing down a hill, you know, with guava trees, and I use those to grab onto because the branches like bend instead of break and don't snap, so you don't like fall down there. You could grab them as you're scurrying down the hill. But the rose apple also kind of grows as a weed over in Hawaii, but would be considered a medium fruit here to grow. Now, I personally am not enthralled with the rose apple flavor. It kind of is like hollow and kind of like a nice texture, but not super sweet or anything like that. But hey, maybe some of you guys like how they taste. I would rather grow a chico sapote instead. These are the dragon fruits, and they have actually many different varieties of dragon fruits, which is really impressive. They even had the super sweet yellow dragon fruits here that are not commonly seen. I don't know what variety this is, but you know, you may have to protect these from the cold. They don't like the cold. They can probably handle the heat. You have to feed them properly. More importantly, on the dragon fruits, on most varieties of dragon fruits, you'll need to hand pollinate them, because the good news about Arizona, unlike Florida or Hawaii, that's a humid and they got all these crazy insects, or even Houston, Texas, where it's humid, you don't have a lot of the bugs and insects that'll mess up or eat the trees. On the same token, it's bad because you don't have the same bugs that will pollinate the trees or the fruits either. So you will need to hand pollinate your dragon fruits, unless, I learned this today, you buy the one from Seamus that will pollinate on its own, which is totally amazing to me. And that's the kind that I would buy so that I could do one less thing in my garden, but still have some delicious dragon fruit to eat. So the next medium fruit I want to show you guys that you guys can grow here in Phoenix, that's not too difficult, is the passion fruit. I love passion fruits. I was in Costa Rica and had some amazing passion fruits that were super sweet, super delicious. I actually happen to love the Jamaican passion fruit. It has like an orange kind of fuzzy skin on the outside. I'm not sure if Seamus sells those here, but he has at least you know, several different varieties, including Sweet Sunrise, a Panama Red, some Grenadillas, which I think are a super larger fruit. The main thing with the passion fruits is don't plant it in full sun. It doesn't like full sun. In many cases, actually, people just leave them in the pots or up pot them, and then, you know, move them where they need to be, but they do need something to climb up on. So I'd probably grow this in a shadier spot and let them climb into the sun if they so choose to do so. All right, the second to last category I want to share with you guys today is actually the medium-high category. This is like if you want to put a lot more work into it, not to say that it's impossible, because Seamus surely has sold many hundreds of trees across the years he's been in business to people that grow their own mangoes here right in Phoenix, but it can take some extra work. For example, he has a whole mango grove right here planted in the ground, but you know what he's done, because he's literally in the middle of a field that's 10 degrees colder than most parts of Phoenix, you know, he's built a structure over it. Now, you may or may not need to build a structure over your mangoes or the fruits in this medium high category that I'll be sharing with you guys next, but surely you will have to take care of them more. So if you do not want to take care of them more, especially do things like protect them from the frost, especially when they're young, once they get more established and they get, you know, thicker tree trunks and more established, you know, they can be more resistant to the cold. But nonetheless, you must realize that we are in a zone 9, and some of these, you know, plants are more tropicals that should be grown in at least a zone 10 or 11 to be optimally successful. So literally, we can mitigate the fact that you're in a zone 9 by doing some things, including the best practices and growing healthier trees that can be more resilient to the colder temperatures or hotter temperatures or the stress. and that's how you got to do it. So once again, this is the section of the video. If you guys don't want to do that much work, check out the previous trees and get one of those instead. So the next medium high fruit tree you guys can grow, and once again, there are many others because I can't cover every different tree here at Seamus's amazing tropical fruit tree nursery, but I'm sure he'll be classifying a lot of his trees in the future in some of these categories to make it easier for you guys. We did talk about that, is like the Adamoya family. So an Adamoya or a sugar apple, such as these guys, which I love. They are so delicious and sweet. I mean, some of these fruits is very hard to find. I mean, it's hard to find ripe sugar apples because they usually pick too early and then they just don't ripen up properly. I've had some of the best ones in Hawaii, and maybe I've had a few in Florida, but to have some in Phoenix is totally amazing, and you guys can grow them if you wanna do the work to make it happen. So the next medium high fruit I wanna show you guys is actually the Jamaican cherry. This is in the video because actually this is one of my favorite fruits actually, so I always like to highlight those that you guys could grow them. It's super fast growing. Once again, you may need to protect them, especially when they're young, for the first couple years, and make sure you feed them properly. The Jamaican cherry makes these like little cherry fruits that could be literally hundreds and littered on the tree. They could grow, you know, in without much care or protection in the Bay Area where it doesn't freeze. California, like Walnut Creek, for example, in the San Diego or Southern California, they're gonna do great. Also in places like Florida, they also do great, but here you will need to better take care of them because they don't like the cold as much. They are super amazing fruit. To me, they taste like a Starburst fruit chew or something, man. They're just so fruity and flavorful, and you have literally hundreds of them on the tree. They're super small little berries. The birds also love them. So the next medium high maintenance fruit you guys can grow here in Phoenix, something that actually puts on fruit multiple times a year when I go to Florida or Hawaii. Actually, it's an easy one in Florida to grow. This is the carambola, also known as the star fruit. The foods are highly perishable, and that's another fruit that if you pick them, they're usually picked unripe because once they're ripe, you know, they go bad fairly quickly. I've had some really good ones in Puerto Rico as well, and you guys can grow them if you want to take more care. Now, once again, I always encourage you guys, I got some nice big 15-gallon size here to get the larger pot size so that the tree will already be more established and more resilient to the stress of the cold, especially here in Phoenix. So now I want to share with you guys actually the last category, and this is like the exceptional category. If you're like a master fruit grower, or you know going into it that you might not ever get fruit off these trees and they might not make it because these trees are definitely not proven yet, although they may be proven one of these days to grow really well in Phoenix. Seamus likes to make some of these guys available for people that want to experiment and figure out if they could actually get some fruit off these, because some people know and love these last two trees, although there's other ones, you know, that I'm not covering in this episode, but the ones that really I want to come out with and share with you guys today are, number one, the sour sop. Sour sop is a, you know, powerful anti-cancer food, not just the fruit. I would say even the leaves are even more powerful than the fruit as an anti-cancer if you do a Google search on that. This one, like below 40-45 degrees, it just totally checks out and you're gonna lose it. So you definitely gotta bring it in and maybe even heat it up a little bit in the wintertime if it's gonna get too cold for you, or you're gonna lose it. So once again, I encourage you guys to grow in the low or the medium or even the medium high category, you know, a lot easier than doing one of these. But of course, if you wanna try your luck at it, you could definitely do it and maybe you'll prove everybody else wrong. All right, the last fruit tree that I wanna show you guys today is the cacao tree, or Themobroma. This is what they make the chocolate bars out of that most of you guys might eat on a regular basis. Cacao is high in antioxidants and polyphenols, although when it is coupled with sugar and milk, it's probably not the healthiest thing for you. You know, I visited cacao farms in Puerto Rico, put a link down below to that video, and they will actually ship you raw cacao pods, or the whole fruit, off the trees that they harvest for you fresh. You could get the seeds, and that'd be a lot less expensive way to try to sprout them and grow them here, because once again, this is also a very high maintenance crop. I mean, I remember when I would go to South Florida to Homestead, right? And the Fruit and Spice Park, right? They have all these amazing tropical fruit trees out on the property, which you should visit if you're in the Homestead area. But the cacao, even in Homestead, Florida, they had in a special greenhouse to keep it even warmer. That being said, since that time when I started originally visiting the Fruit and Spice Park, because the climate is getting warmer, now I hear that people are able to grow the cacao tree even outside of the greenhouse and be successful. I still have to see one yet, but normally these are like grown in Hawaii. But once again, Seamus makes these available if you want to experiment and see if you could grow some cacao in Phoenix. And I think if you did, that would be completely amazing, and you could literally set the standard for how to do it. So the next thing I want to do is we're going to go ahead and interview Seamus, but before I do, I really want to cover this area of the nursery, and this is probably one of the most important parts of the nursery aside from all the fruit trees. You know, I see a lot of people basically carting off fruit trees, which is good and grand and all, but what people fail to realize that the soil here, or lack thereof soil here in Phoenix, which is mostly like desert sand, maybe a little bit better than sand because you might have some clay depending on where you live, is that it is very deficient and it's not the proper soil to grow the fruit trees. Number one, the pH is bad. Number two, there's not a lot of organic matter. And Seamus could probably say about five more things at least that's not good with the soil. And that's why some of the things he sells here, some of the different fertilizers that he sells, like the monthly in-ground fertilizer, the six-month fertilizer, the sulfur, the manganese, the chelated iron, you know, the different kind of, you know, fish emulsions and kelp meals and the different kind of compost and sulfur and rock dust, you have some azomite, the worm castings are critical for your success. So do not leave the nursery without asking Seamus or one of the handy, helpful workers here, what nutrients do I need to ensure my success? You should ask them that so that you succeed, because you just spent a chunk of change on a fruit tree and you don't want to get it home, just dig a hole and put it in the ground and then it dies, or you put it in the ground and then it just never makes fruit. Like, I bought this fruit tree 3 years ago, it didn't make fruit. Well, think about it. If you didn't eat food, how long would you be living? How long would you be reproducing if you didn't eat food? You need to make sure you get the good nutrition in the soil, and Seamus will tell you exactly what you need to feed that tree. Because what people don't know is that the tree will only produce fruit, or literally reproduce, that's what the tree's doing, if it is completely healthy. If it's not completely healthy, it's just struggling to stay alive. And even more importantly is to give the tree the nutrients so that over the summer when it's really flourishing in the sun, right, it's hunkering down, it's getting stronger. If you wanna build muscles, you gotta work out, and you can't just expect to lift 100 pounds of weights if you've never worked out before, right? By getting the tree strong during the summer when you're getting all the sun, and it's creating photosynthesis and the energy and the root exudates and the sugars that go into the tree to make it strong, it is then more resilient for the cold weather should it come. And if you don't do all this, you're gonna fail. So what I wanna do next for you guys is we're gonna go ahead and sit down with Seamus, and he's gonna drop some knowledge on you so that you guys can be more successful growing the fruit trees here in Phoenix. So now the opportunity to interview the fruit tree gardening growing expert here in Phoenix, Seamus O'Leary, woo! All right, so I got a couple questions for Seamus. The first question is, why did you start a tropical fruit tree nursery here in Phoenix, of all places in the world? Because I know, like, you know, people would grow peaches and more, you know, cool climate, true fruit trees here, but nobody really tried to grow, you know, tropicals on any big scale, you know, other than when you started like 12 years ago.
Well, there are two reasons. The first was that I wanted to be able to figure out why we supposedly couldn't grow these trees here, solve that riddle. I wanted to prove that we could actually grow these types of fruit trees here in the desert. Two, I saw that there was a large demand and not enough supply, so I saw a business opportunity with that. The first part was somewhat ego. I wanted to say, hey, you know, we can grow this here. The part of it was, you know, financially motivated. I wanted to do something that I had a passion for a living, and that those two things kind of brought me together, and here we are.
Wonderful. Yeah, it's been many, many, many years later, and you're successful at doing this. Now, the other thing that I tried to make a point in this video today was that you can't just take a tree you bought here and just stick it in the ground and expect it to make fruit for you in a couple years. It might not even make it through the summer or the winter, depending on how you're treating it. There's a lot of nuances you know, to basically be able to successfully grow a fruit tree. And I tried to also explain in this video, some are a lot easier, low maintenance, you know, medium high, or even high maintenance, that you might not even want to try if you're not going to be successful. That's why I've tried to break up this video. But even beyond that, I give you the basics and the choosing the right tree variety. There's so many other factors besides tree variety. So we're going to try to ask Seamus some of the nuances and some of the questions regarding that. So Seamus, first, let's talk about the microclimates, because that's super critical to your success or failure.
Understanding your microclimate should be the number one factor that drives you to buy a particular type of tree. You either have the necessary microclimate to support that type of tree, or you don't. You can create that over time by growing larger trees and creating windbreaks and such, but you might not have the yard that is good for an avocado per se, which most of Phoenix does not. If you have a lot of vegetation, good windbreaks, you can get away with something like that. You might have a yard that's more appropriate for moringa or mulberry or pomegranate. So understanding what a microclimate is, understanding what microclimates you have in your yard, understanding that every yard has different microclimates within it, and then figuring out what do you want to plant. Is it appropriate for your yard? If it isn't, what is option two, option three? Figuring out what your microclimates are and what is appropriate for that particular yard placement.
Wonderful. Yeah, microclimates are especially critical, especially for me as primarily a vegetable gardener. You know, when I have shade, I could grow, cool things in the shade, and I could grow different things in the sun, especially in the middle of the summer when it's super hot. But another thing, Seamus, especially living in the desert myself, is the soil. You know, some nurseries in town will say you can just dig a hole and plant the tree and you're gonna be fine without amending it or without doing anything. I would personally not agree with that, and I know you would not agree with that. So you wanna talk about, you know, I mean, the soil here is not the tropics. It's not, doesn't have like composted, you know, tree forest material built up. I mean, it's actually very low in organic matter and the wrong pH and all this stuff. So you wanna talk about the soil and how critical that is for your success.
So the biggest thing here in Phoenix is most of the yards contain two types of soil. It's either clay or compacted caliche. Very few of the yards, and I'm lucky to have one of them, are heavy in sand where it drains very well. So if your yard has clay or caliche, you need to understand what you need to do to amend the soil or change out the soil completely to grow the type of tree that it is that you want. Most fruit trees are going to want a well-draining, fast-draining soil, some organic material. The organic material can depend, the type of tree can determine, will determine how much organic material you want. So understanding your tree and the tree's needs in regards to soil construction is right there behind microclimates, understanding what it wants. Digging a hole and planting in straight native soil is fine for native trees that are acclimated to that type of soil. But as far as I understand, there really are not any native fruit trees to the Phoenix area. So everything is going to do better with a soil that is constructed to fit their needs. Yes, are there some trees that are going to grow just fine in native soil? Sure, or at least what we define as fine or okay. But how much better would they do if you actually gave them a soil that was better constructed to fit their needs? So understanding the soil needs of that particular tree is imperative, and then go about constructing that soil, which is nothing to do. I mean, it's not a lot of labor. It's a few minutes here and there. Give the tree the proper home that it wants, and it'll be comfortable and it'll thrive.
Wow. Yeah, I mean, I'm all about the soil and building your soil and adding, you know, organic matter and different inoculants and worm castings and good compost and getting the microbes and the fungi and the fungirls in there. Super critical, super important. Another thing, Seamus, that I want to talk to you about is, like, we eat three times a day, right? But many people think, once again, they could just dig a hole and plant the tree and not even maybe fertilize it once and then never fertilize it again, and it's gonna make fruit for you. Well, maybe if it's a native tree, you know, might do that. But, you know, the fruit trees are high demand crops, you know, for nutrition, especially growing them in a climate that they are not totally intended to grow in. So you want to talk about feeding your trees, how often, how much, what kind of different, you know, nutrients you need to do to make sure you're going to get good yields, because the difference between adding, you know, feeding more regularly than not could be fruit, having fruit or not having fruit, having 10 fruit versus having 20 fruit or 30 fruit, or a bumper crop.
Or having your tree live at all.
Yeah, having it, yeah, not even having it lose its life.
So understanding your tree's needs and what it wants in regards to food is something that I think is lost on many gardeners. We tend to overlook it. We think of it as something that we do 3 times a year. It's something that we do when we get around to it. I know personally that if I don't have X amount of protein and carbs and veggies and fruits throughout the day, I feel weak at the end of the day. If I don't have enough water by a certain time of the day, I've got a migraine at the end of the day. If I don't eat correctly, I don't feel good. My energy level is low. I'm not going to be able to produce. I'm not going to be a productive human being. It's the same thing with the plants. If you don't understand what they want, when they want, and make sure that they get it, you're kind of wasting your time. You're throwing money on the ground, literally and figuratively. Different trees are going to have different needs. The basics are fresh compost, worm castings, nice thick layer of mulch, providing organic material to the soil. Some of the trees have higher needs, different mineral nutrient deficiencies that happen here in Phoenix because of the high pH of our soil. That mangoes, as an example, they need a shot of chelated iron and chelated manganese regularly, whereas a peach tree or an apple tree might not need that. A peach tree might need something else, you know, fish and seaweed and some fresh compost a few times a year might suffice for that. So understanding the requirements, the nutritional requirements of the particular tree that you want to buy, and then satisfying those requirements are something that I think we don't spend enough time on. I know many people don't want to get too far into it because it's a little bit more time, not much, costs a little bit of money. No one wants to spend any more money than they have to. But what's the point of spending $50 on a tree if you're not going to take care of it? It's going to be dead anyway. You've just thrown $50 on the tree. I'd rather spend $75 on the tree and the nutrients needed for the tree and eat fruit off the tree rather than throw that $50 away. You haven't gained anything by not taking care of the tree. You've just wasted the money that you spent on the tree. So,
yeah, wow. And I mean, talking about food, I mean, besides food, we need to drink water. I mean, he'll get migraines if he doesn't drink water, so we got to make sure he has his water. But the trees need water also. This is a desert, guys. It barely rains here in Phoenix unless you're getting monsoons. I mean, last year they didn't have hardly any. So you want to talk about watering needs? I mean, some trees are more thirsty than others. Like, some people are more thirsty than others.
Honestly, you're not going to understand the water requirements of your tree until you've spent a year with them observing at different temperatures, different sun exposures, different layers, thicknesses of mulch, what the specific water requirements of the tree are. Many times we get customers that come in and they want to know, how long should I set the timer for? Well, I don't know the volume of water that you're giving it. I don't know the spread. I don't know the construction of your soil. I cannot tell you how long you should set your timer for. What I can tell you is that you need to go out in the yard 2-3 times a day, morning when you get home from work and at night before you go to bed. Look at the tree, look at the soil, feel underneath the mulch, observe. That's going to tell you how often and how much you should water. Every soil is constructed different. I'm in a unique situation here in South Phoenix at the base of South Mountain that I'm on runoff from the mountain. My soil here is very sandy. My soil drains very quickly, which means I have to water more frequently. To help cut down on the frequency, because I don't have all the time in the world to do that, I go thicker with the mulch than I would maybe at my house, where I have compacted soil, doesn't need as frequent of a water. So maybe at my house I've got 6 to 8 inches of mulch, whereas here I try to go a foot or two depth with mulch on top of the soil, cuts down on the frequency of water. Most of you watching this are probably on clay or compacted caliche. You're not going to have to water as often. So, but you're not going to know how long the water should run for and what the volume of water should be until you've spent time in the yard observing the trees at different temperatures throughout the year, understanding that soil, summertime needs to be more frequent, spring and fall in between, wintertime might be next to nothing if it's a banana or a papaya or a plumeria. So nobody can tell you how often you should water. You want to get out there in the yard, pay attention, check the soil. The first year is going to tell you, the second year you're going to have it down. I'm not a big fan of automated water because that gives, going out to water my trees gives me a chance to observe the tree, see if there's any problems going on, looking at the soil. Do you see worms and bugs going on? Which means that's a good thing. The soil is moist. If everything's bone dry and you don't see any life, you probably need to add some more organic material and up the frequency of the water. So water is life and death for the trees before everything else. And I see that probably as the number one failure of trees, non-native trees here in the Phoenix area, is improper watering. Watering is a science unto itself. Your landscaper is not going to be able to tell you the frequency and the volume of water that that particular tree needs. You're gonna learn that. You're gonna tell your landscaper how long the timer should run for, how many, you know, bubblers you need to have to that size well. But understanding the water requirements of the tree is like imperative, first and foremost, before anything else.
So another thing I wanna ask you, Seamus, is why should not people use a drip system or integrate, you know, oh, I got my lawn, the sprinklers come on, I could just sprinkle the tree when my sprinklers come on, or I could use my existing drip system on a, you know, a set program because I'm watering my vegetable garden with it with the same times.
Spraying water, that works for grass, shallow roots. Trees, you want to encourage the root growth, you want to encourage root development, and that means pushing the water 5, 10, 15 foot below the surface. Roots will chase water, water will follow gravity. So in order to get the water deep, you have to slow water. You have to turn the water down and let it run longer. Using drips here in Phoenix is not a good idea because dripping water, drip, drip, drip in one spot on hard compacted soil, do you really believe that you're getting a large volume of water 8 to 10 foot below the surface by dripping water in one location when it's 115 degrees outside? It doesn't make any sense. You want to create a lake around the tree. You want to water the surrounding soil. When you water, you're not watering the tree itself. You're watering the soil, which will encourage the roots to grow out, which will encourage root development, which will give you a nice, happy, healthy tree. So drips are appropriate for vegetables and flowers, shallow rooted plants that will deal with water penetration of 5-6 inches into the soil. Trees, you need to get water 5, 10, 15 foot into the earth, and you can't do that through dripping water. Could you imagine if you tried to live through a Phoenix summer, not by drinking water, but actually dripping water into your mouth? It doesn't make any sense. It's no different than with the trees. The trees are living things. They operate on the same requirements as we do in regards to nutrition and hydration, shade protection, cold protection. You have to treat these, if not better, I would say, than a human being. Proper hydration, they'll handle our summers no problem. Last year we had the hottest summer on record. Our trees were fine. Our garden was fine. Everything was lush green throughout the summer. We upped the water frequency. We upped the duration of the water, upped the thickness of mulch on top of the ground to cut down on the evaporation. The thicker you go with mulch, the less you're going to have to water. Mulch is cheaper than water. Keep piling on the grass clippings, the leaves, the wood chips. So what if you have to buy a truckload of mulch every year from the Arizona worm farm and pile that on? It's a lot cheaper than having to up your water.
Yeah, water is super critical for life, literally. That's how life on Earth started. Wouldn't happen without water. So the next thing, Seamus, I want to talk about is soil pH. Mm. I know soil pH is huge, and you know, you could get locked out if you got too acid or too alkaline, and of course some trees like a certain range and all this kind of stuff. And I mean, you're the expert because I don't know this kind of stuff, like what minerals need to be unlocked at certain pHs and all this kind of stuff that you're the expert on. So you want to download real quick, you know, with my viewers who are watching this who want to grow fruit trees in Phoenix, what do they really need to do and why should they be concerned about soil pH?
Well, first of all, I appreciate your kind words, but I am far from an expert. I only share my experiences and experiences of others. In regards to pH, if the pH is out of balance, the tree is unable to eat. The nutrients are locked out from the tree, plain and simple. Anything that's not native to the Phoenix area in general wants a pH of about 6. The easiest way to find this out, what the pH requirements of your tree is just Google it. So mango tree pH requirements, citrus tree pH requirements. You'll find that most of these trees, 99% of these trees, want a pH of about 6. And it'll tell you anything above 7, the tree doesn't eat and it dies a slow death. All of Phoenix, the soil and the water, is 8.5, between 8, 8.5. If you're on flood irrigated property, sometimes you've got a high 7. If you look at the pH chart, which you can find on Google as well, it shows you what nutrients are available at what pH levels. And when you're at 6, the nutrients that these trees require are available. When you get to 7, some things start to disappear. When you're at 8, it's like the tree is trying to grow on the moon. So mangoes, as an example, mangoes become deficient in iron and manganese, two very important nutrients for the mango tree, at about 7. When you get above 7, we're 8.5. 8.5, nothing is available to the tree, and we wonder why the trees don't grow here. It's the same thing with citrus. So adjusting your soil for pH is mandatory. It's just as important as water. I do it through a couple different means, 3 different means. A, I use soil sulfur. I drop that on top of the ground 3 times a year. It's 1 tablespoon per square foot of area. Every product is gonna have its own application rate, so you wanna check that out. But I use the Tiger 90 brand 3 times a year on anything that's not native to Arizona. B, I repetitively pile on organic material to help adjust the chemistry, the composition of our soil. Once again, compost and mulch is a lot cheaper than, you know, chemicals and sulfur and water and what have you. So keep piling on the organic material to change the chemistry of our soil. That's going to help buffer the salts that are in our soil. 3, when you water, slow deep water. That helps wash the salts that are in the soil surface and the water away from the root zone of the tree. The high saline content of our water and soil is the largest contributing factor to the high pH of our soil. So helping to wash the salts away from the tree, away from the root zone, is going to help buffer the pH a bit. With those 3 things, and especially the soil sulfur, within about 6 months, you can get that pH down to generally about mid to high 6s. Keep at it. Now your trees are able to eat. When your pH is at 8 plus, it's the equivalent of trying to eat a Thanksgiving dinner through a straw. It doesn't matter how much fertilizer you give it, the Miracle-Gro garbage, you know, this and that and so on. You can throw all you want down on the ground and spend any amount of money, but if the pH is out of balance, it's all being wasted. So you have to lower the pH so that the tree can eat the nutrients that are naturally available in our soil, and then also that you're supplementing with in regards to the other products and what have you. So soil pH, literally, go to Google. Google the pH requirements of that tree, look at the pH chart, understand what your tree needs. It literally, you can save yourself 20 years of time, frustration, money by spending 2 minutes on Google, figuring out the pH thing. You're good to go. And that applies to vegetables, exotic fruit trees, common fruit trees, citrus, bamboo. It doesn't matter. Anything not native to Arizona wants a pH of in the 6 neighborhood. So understanding that is like, You should spend 2 minutes on Google really before you go to a nursery and purchase a tree.
Wise words for sure. I mean, this is all the things that Seamus has learned literally over the last 12 years, you know, growing tropical fruit trees, you know, selling them to people and getting feedback from others. And now we're literally dropping it on you in one video. This is probably the most important video you could watch if you live in Phoenix and you want to grow tropical fruit trees or any fruit trees for that matter. So be sure to share this video with other Phoenicians that live here that want to grow fruit trees or want to be successful at it, to really learn what you need to know to do that. So the next question, Seamus, is, you know, I know fruit trees, many of your fruit trees here actually will not make it through, may not make it through the cold weather. And how does the cold weather can be a really, you know, negative factor in what is needed to protect some of the trees, because some of these ones that I showed you guys will last through the cold weather, but some of them won't. You know, what are some of the techniques needed depending on the level of tree that I discussed, you know, the low, medium, high, or high? You know, what is needed to protect them from the cold, to make them more resilient?
There's a few different things that factor into how a tree is going to handle winter. A, the age of the tree, the thickness of the tree. If it's a small plant, if it's a 3-gallon plant and, you know, it's thinner than a pencil, it's probably gonna have some trouble with the winter. You're gonna wanna protect it a little bit more than you would, let's say, a tree that's got a nice, you know, 4 or 5 years old and it's got a nice thick caliper to it. So understanding the cold tolerance of that particular species versus the microclimate in your yard, understanding that every winter is gonna be a little different. I'm often asked, will this tree live here? Well, that question we can spider web off into 8 different ways, you know, going down the rabbit hole with that. There's a lot of variables that go into that. This part of town where we are here, South Phoenix, up against the base of South Mountain in Levine, is the coldest part of Phoenix. It's actually probably the worst part of town to have a tropical fruit tree nursery. We have to protect our trees through the use of frost fabric. We also use heaters inside that frost fabric to protect our inventory. There's a reason that I don't have mangoes and papayas and some of the other fun stuff out here in the garden, which is unprotected, because I'm a realist, and I've killed too many trees figuring out what'll work here. We get really cold in this part of town. We get 8 to 10 degrees colder than 3 miles north of here in central Phoenix. I've got to be realistic on what's going to work in this part of the yard. So out here, I might have jamun, tamarind, guavas, pomegranates, mulberries. Those handle the cold without protection. I also start off more mature because I don't want to have to start over next year, and I don't want to have to worry about protecting those trees. So I invest a little bit more and buy more mature trees that can handle the cold that my yard gets. And again, understanding the microclimates that you're dealing with should dictate how you shop for a tree. The other part of the yard where I have the mango orchard and my tropical garden, I've built structures to protect the trees. That part of the yard is not going to accommodate jackfruit, coconut, soursop, ice cream bean, and all the fun stuff. So I've built structures that I can wrap with frost fabric in the winter. When we built the structure, we ran conduit out there. We've got 110 and 220 out there that I can plug any type of heater on into and help protect those trees. So again, understanding your microclimate, and every yard has different microclimates within it, should dictate how you shop for a tree. Your budget is also going to factor into what size tree you start with. Some trees, you know, you can get away with starting from a seed or a small plant, such as a pomegranate or a moringa. You don't need to invest in a larger tree. Some of the slower growing, more cold sensitive trees, such as a mango or a star fruit, might be worthwhile to step up and spend a little bit more to get something that's a little thicker, that's a little bit more mature, maybe something that's been on the property a little longer and it's already been through a winter or two. That's going to be of benefit to you. So using frost fabric, structures, it doesn't have to be a fancy structure. It could be steel, it could be PVC pipe, it could be, you know, a wood frame. If you don't want to go through that expense and trouble to build a structure around a tree, you can also container grow these trees. Mangoes don't need to be in the ground. You really want to have a mango orchard, but you don't want to have to deal with protecting the trees through the winter, which is completely understandable. Container grow them. You can container grow a mango for 7 or 8 years in a 15-gallon size pot. Weatherman says, hey, Wednesday night it's going to be 31 degrees. Pick the tree up and bring it inside the garage. Put it back out during the day. You know, just you learn to pay attention to the weather. So it's not a all or nothing deal. Well, will the tree grow outside unprotected? There's things that you can do to mitigate the risks. There's things that you can do to protect the trees. There's things that you can do to mitigate your investment in it through either container growing or a little bit of frost fabric, or maybe stepping up and buying a little bit more of a mature tree. So winter can be dealt with easy enough if you understand what you're dealing with and you understand what that tree will deal with, and that's what should dictate how you should shop for a particular tree. But we can deal with winter here easy enough. You can container grow mangoes in Madison, Wisconsin if you wanted to. Every grower is going to have a different level of effort, work that they want to put into it. Figure out who you are and what you are and what you're willing to put into it. Some of us are crazy. Some of us spend thousands of dollars building steel frames around the trees because I really enjoy going out in the middle of January and looking at my mango orchard. I don't want to bitch and moan about it in March. Oh, I've got to start over and oh, this and that and so on. I like looking at my trees year round and I like seeing healthy, pretty trees. I spend a little bit more money protecting my trees, but I also understand that many people don't want to deal with that. So buying trees that are going to fit your level of motivation, effort, finances, space, what you want to put into it, really should dictate how you shop for trees.
Excellent answer. I mean, that's why I made this video today. Once again, we got the ignore, like the moringa, and then we got the low, medium, medium, high, and high maintenance, so that, you know, this is kind of dictates in some levels, you know, ones that are easier or harder, so you can pick the right ones. You will be successful. So Seamus, we talked about the winter, let's talk about the summer. This is probably one of the hottest places in the country for summer weather, over 100, probably 10 degrees on a regular basis for at least 30, 60 days straight during July and August. So how can the trees, or how can somebody mitigate the heat from damaging the trees, or does the heat damage the trees, or do the trees love it, they suck it up? Like me out in the sun getting the tan.
Yeah, about that. So understanding your microclimates, understanding where your windbreaks are, understanding where your morning sun, afternoon shade versus afternoon or morning shade, afternoon sun, you know, vice versa, different times of the year dictate how well your tree is going to do through the summer. We have found that heat is not the issue on the plants. If the plants are properly hydrated, And depending on the age of the plant and the type of the plant, might need a little bit more shade than others, depending on the percentage of shade, depending on whether it's a filtered sun or a complete blackout shade. Those are the factors that go into determining whether a tree's gonna make it through the summer. We've proven here many times over that the heat is not the issue. This past summer was the hottest summer that we had here on record in Phoenix. I think we had 70, 75 days of over 110. We had no let up June through September. It was brutal on us. In regards to the trees, that was the time of year when everything looked the best. And we figured out, wow, upping the water, making sure the trees are properly fed, really did wonders. Making sure that, you know, that avocado was shaded versus this, you know, the palm tree that wants sun, they're in the right positions in the yard, in the right microclimates, did wonders. We didn't lose anything over the summer. Watering, upping your water in the summer and understanding the water requirements of the tree and actually getting off the couch to get out there to look at your soil, get off your ass, check to see is your soil drying out, which you don't want anything drying out in the summertime. The common excuse is, well, I don't water because I'm afraid to overwater. You really can't overwater in Phoenix unless you're on clay, which you really shouldn't be growing in clay, but you can't overwater in Phoenix when we're in the middle of a 75 day spell of 110 plus, and many of those days are 117. You're not gonna overwater. Keep the hoses running. More water is the answer 90% of the time to your summer failures, to the problems in the summertime. We grow vegetables in full sun with proper hydration. The sprinklers come on twice a day for 15 minutes. We're eating out of the garden summer round. The mangoes thrive here in the summertime. The bananas do well as long as everything's properly hydrated. The problem is that many people do not adjust the watering schedules to fit the time of year. They allow the landscaper to determine how often and when often the water should come on for the tree, and it's not adjusted throughout the year. So understanding that March and May and August watering is a completely different world apart from each other, you'll see it in the health of the trees and whether they make it through the summer or not, but the heat is not the issue. Sun exposure and heat are two completely different conversations, but the heat is not the issue on these plants. Many of the trees that we deal with are tropical fruit trees, tropical flower trees. They come from hot climates. Tropical trees love the heat. The heat is not the issue. The winter is the issue. Heat is not the issue in the summertime. You shouldn't be losing anything in the summer. But understanding the tree's requirements, where it should be placed in the yard in regards to sun exposure, and then adjusting your water schedule to fit the temperatures at that time are what's going to factor into whether your trees make it through the summer or not.
Wow. So we've already covered so many different elements of being able to successfully grow a fruit tree here in Phoenix. Are there any elements that I miss, Seamus, that you want to touch on?
Few things to just that touch on. Keep piling on the organic material. You should never stop with that. I get many pictures shown to me of what's wrong with my tree, and I see this much mulch on top of the ground. That's not doing anything for you. All you're doing is making a mess. You might as well just have a layer of cigarette butts on the ground. Like literally 6 to 8 inches minimum, and I think that's still shy. 12 inches really, because the way our heat and microbial activity bring in the decomposition of the organic material in the summertime. If you don't mind spending time in your yard every 2 weeks reapplying mulch, sure, keep at it with this. But if you only want to do that 2 or 3 times throughout the year, just go crazy with it and put a foot, if not two, of mulch on top of the ground. It's going to save you on water. It's going to save you on fertilizing your trees. It's going to help with lowering the pH of the soil. Proper hydration, adjusting throughout the year. Understanding the shade sun requirements of the tree, it's easy enough to do. Proper cold protection, that's really about it. Yeah, and then fresh materials, you know, in regards to your compost and your worm castings, make sure the products that you're using are fresh. Yeah.
Wonderful. So I think I want to get into a few more questions before I got to run, actually. One of the questions is that, you know, I've been to other gardens and farms and people growing food and fruit trees in Phoenix in the past, and I'm not going to mention any names in this video, but I will say that, you know, some of them didn't make it, right? And, you know, in this video, I tried to dispel why, you know, people that I've shown in the past in videos didn't make it. Do you want to have any comments on this topic?
A couple things I want to touch on in regards to worm castings and compost. I'm fortunate enough, I'm in a very unique position that my neighbor is the Arizona worm farm. And when he moved in and I got a crash course on what proper compost and worm casting are, I learned very quickly that this product needs to be worked all the time. It needs to be turned over. It needs to be watered. It needs to be tested. And I quickly learned that what you buy at the large box stores is dried out overpriced soil. So when you're composting for your trees, when you're applying fresh worm castings, you want to make sure that that product has been in the bag no more than 7 days max. Once you take a living organism out of the pile where it's getting turned and it's getting oxygenated and it's getting hydrated and you put it into an airtight bag, the microbial life in there starts to die off. It's got about a 7 day shelf life. So you want to make sure that when you're purchasing compost, when you're purchasing worm castings, that it's actually fresh. It should be somewhat moist. You want to make sure of the source and where it's coming from, the inputs that are going into it. Is the product being regularly tested? Is the process open to the public to see how it's being made? Are they upfront with their answers? And, you know, they're open to answering questions in regards to how is the product being made? You know, are things being grown on the property in that product? So fresh compost and fresh worm castings are something I've kind of got a fresh crash course in over the past couple of years, being neighbors with the Arizona worm farm, thank God, that opened my eyes to what we can actually do with these trees if they get the proper nutrients. And if you're getting what you actually pay for, that's something that you'll notice that at many places that sell compost and worm castings, that the product just isn't fresh. And you want to be able to feel the product, and you can feel and you can smell the life in it. If it's not, it's just overpriced soil at that point.
Yeah, I mean, I completely agree. I'm all about the quality, right? You want to get good quality castings, and you know, I'm glad that Seamus offers some of the high quality fresh castings with a constant turnover, because he only brings in as much as he's going to sell in the next few days, and it's going right out with people as they're getting their fruit trees so that they could be more successful. I mean, that's why Seamus is here to you know, make sure, ensure your success, because your success will ensure his success, that he will continue to be in business and be able to provide these amazing tropical fruit trees here in Phoenix. So, Seamus, as we you know, end up this video, are there any final comments or words of wisdom you'd like to share with my viewers today?
Don't be afraid to try, and don't be discouraged if the first or second go around doesn't work out for you. I've learned how to keep trees alive, grow trees, make them thrive through trial and error. That's the only way that you're going to learn. Don't give up because a tree didn't make it, because odds are the tree was fine. It's the grower that didn't make it. So understand that none of us are experts, and no one's going to be able to grow everything successfully. Also, nature weeds out the weak. Not everything is going to live. So don't give up because the first year or two you didn't get really good, you know, juicy tomatoes. I can't grow a tomato to grow my life. I know nothing about them. I can grow a mango. I can grow some bananas, but some of the other stuff I just don't have any experience with. So it's going to take me a few go rounds before I am successful with the vegetable gardening thing. So it doesn't mean I shouldn't try it. And I shouldn't be discouraged by it, even though I am a little bit. But don't give up. Ask successful people. Ask people, what are you growing? The people that are actually successfully growing these things in their yard, those are the ones that you want to model your growing techniques after. Going to the internet isn't always the best place to get firsthand growing experience, advice for your situation, for your microclimate, for your area. Ask if there's any local garden groups in your area. Walk your neighborhood. I like to walk the neighborhood at night and see who's growing what. 9 out of 10 houses in the neighborhood that I, you know, walk past, they're not growing anything. I'm not going to ask them how to grow something. Why I would do that on the internet makes no sense whatsoever. But I'll stop at the house where I see some sugarcane growing, and I see some really beautiful citrus, and I might see some bananas growing. I might try to catch them outside and say, hey, how are you doing this? Where did you get your plant from? What are you feeding with? How are you watering? Pay attention to the sun shade exposure. Ask them how they're dealing with winter if needed. So ask the people that are actually growing things in their yard how they're doing it, and then try to follow after that, pattern your growing techniques after them. That's probably the best bit of advice that I can give someone starting out.
Wow. I mean, I would completely agree with Seamus there. Learn as you grow. You know, we have the most powerful supercomputers. Our brains know it's not in your pocket. It's not your cell phone. But people do not apply themselves. People just want, Seamus, how much do I water? What fertilizers? Dude, you got to figure out stuff on your own to make it successful. There's so many different variables. And I mean, we need to learn on our own. And this is part of the fun of growing fruits and vegetables and growing your own food at home, is that you get to learn And more importantly, you'll build brain plasticity, because when you learn things and you have to figure stuff out, right, it keeps you young. So stay younger by growing some tropical fruit trees in a garden at home and figure stuff out and always be curious about how to do it and how could I improve it, how could I tweak it. This is what Simply Seamus has been doing here. I do with my vegetable garden, and you guys could do too, because we literally dropped the bomb on you guys today with so much information that you're not going to hear anywhere else. So Seamus, I know, so where are you located and how can somebody find you, and what are your hours? Because I mean, the best thing to do is just come down and visit in person. I wouldn't bother calling them up or anything like that, right? You want to see the trees, you want to experience this place because it is completely amazing.
So the best way to get a hold of us, honestly, is to come on down to the nursery. We could spend some time with you and discuss the growing of the trees. Our website is greenlifebyseamusoleary.com. We do have a Facebook group for our customers and clientele to discuss their experiences, pros and cons of each tree, growing them here in the area, and that is called Living the Green Life, and that's on Facebook. We are at 8640 South 19th Avenue in Phoenix, Arizona. Our hours do change depending on what the season is like, so I'd recommend going to the website to see what our current hours are. But really, like, the two best resources would be come down to the nursery. We can spend a few minutes with you and share with you what we know about growing these trees here in the Phoenix area. If you're not able to do that, or you want to, you know, gather a little bit more information first, our Facebook group, once again, that's called Living the Green Life, is a very good resource. First-hand experience, not hearsay, from clients of ours, what has worked for them, what hasn't worked, whether it's in agreement with something that I preach or something contrary to it, it's fine. But yeah, really, come on down to the nursery or visit our Facebook group. Our YouTube channel, of course, is Seamus O'Leary. So.
Wonderful. Thank you, Seamus. I'll put links down below to his website. I'll put his address down below. I just encourage you guys to come on out, and a link to his Facebook and his YouTube as well. So if you're going to want to learn more about Seamus and what he's got going on here, and if you guys are looking for tropical fruit trees in Phoenix, this is the place I recommend you guys go. So I think that's pretty much the end of this episode. It's actually getting dark. I spent most of my day here so I could film this video. That's probably a bit longer than I probably wanted to, but that's what it is. Because, you know, I'm here to make sure that you are successful. That's why Seamus is here doing what he does day in and day out to ensure your success, so that you guys can grow your own high-quality food at home and be successful at it, because he basically proved all the people that told him you can't go tropical fruit in Phoenix wrong, and now he's allowing you guys and teaching you guys the knowledge that he's learned and learned from so many of his, you know, clients over the many years. So if you like this video, want me to come out to visit Seamus again next time in Phoenix, hey, please be sure to give this video a big thumbs up, and more importantly, please be sure to share this with other gardeners and farmers and people that want to grow their own tropical fruit in Phoenix. This, in my opinion, is the best resource to do so. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new and upcoming episodes. I've come out every 5 to 7 days. You never know where I'll show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. And make sure you click the little bell so you get notified as my new videos come out. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. I have a bunch of videos I've made in the past in Phoenix, showing with you guys some of the things you can grow, and showing you guys some cool examples of what people are doing here in Phoenix, as well as some other resources that I found in the area. And I will be having a few more episodes while I am still traveling here in Phoenix coming up, so make sure you check out for those. But yeah, 1500 videos on this channel, more videos than anybody else, and long format videos to really get into the nitty-gritty to tell you guys what you really need to know to be successful at growing fruit trees in Phoenix or wherever I end up traveling. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time, and until then, remember, keep on growing.